Turn your Bibles, if you would please, the book of Exodus, chapter 33. The book of Exodus, chapter 33. And tonight we're just going to get right into the Word. And I believe the Lord's laid upon my heart a passage of Scripture. And something I feel that has been on my heart recently out of this passage, Exodus chapter 33, and beginning with verse 12 and reading through verse 18. And it's been in my spirit so much recently, and in praying about tonight's service, the Lord led me to this passage of Scripture to bring for you tonight. And I feel it's an in-season word. It's a word that we need to hear. I feel that this word will be an encouragement to you. I believe that this word can challenge you. It can convict you. Whatever is needed, God will do it through His word.
Amen.
Exodus chapter 33 and verse 12, if you're there, say amen.
Amen.
And it says, "Then Moses said to the Lord, 'See, you say to me, bring up this people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name.'" Boy, isn't that nice? The Lord knows us by name.
Amen.
"And you have also found grace in my sight. Now therefore I pray, if I have found grace in your sight, show me your way." That's Moses speaking to the Lord. "Lord, if I found grace in your sight, then show me your way that I may know you. And that I might find grace in your sight and consider that this nation," that's Israel, "is your people."
Amen.
And then he said to him, verse 14, "And God said to Moses, 'My presence will go with you and I will give you rest.'"
Amen.
I'm going to read that again. "God said to him, 'My presence will go with you and I will give you rest.'" And then Moses responded in verse 15, and he said, "If your presence does not go with us, then do not bring us up from here. For how then will it be known that your people and I have found grace in your sight, except you go with us? So we shall be separate, you are your people and I, from all the people who are upon the face of the earth." So the Lord said to Moses, "I will also do this thing that you have spoken, for you have found grace in my sight, and I know you by name."
Hallelujah.
And in verse 18, I'll just finish here, but this is a whole new message. Could be a whole new message. But in verse 18, Moses said, "Lord, please show me your glory."
Hallelujah.
And tonight there's so many things out of this passage that I could focus on, but I feel in my heart what to focus on tonight, what God said to Moses in verse 14, when God said to Moses, "My presence will go with you and I will give you rest." My presence will go with you and I will give you rest. In other words, you don't have anything to worry about because I'm going to go with you and I'm going to take care of it all. Hallelujah. So don't worry about it. Hallelujah. I'm preaching before I'm preaching. Don't worry about it. God's got it all taken care of, and my presence will go with you.
Hallelujah.
Now Moses was so desperate, he said, "Lord, if your presence doesn't go with us, then don't even take us up from here." But God gave him that promise, and I'm going to minister on that tonight. My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. Would you pray with me? Father, we just come before you tonight in the wonderful name of Jesus. And Lord, I just ask you, Lord, for your spirit to move in a mighty way. I ask that, Lord, your anointing would flow, that you would anoint me to speak with clarity of thought and speech, that your anointing would rest upon us tonight to receive. And I'm praying that, God, you would encourage your people. I'm praying that, Lord, that river of the Holy Spirit would flow. And Lord, there would be a fresh wind of the Holy Spirit tonight, that you would refresh your people.
Yes.
Lord, strengthen your people tonight in the name of Jesus. Even convict if conviction is needed.
Yes.
Lord, do what's needed tonight in your presence.
Yes.
And God, we give you all the praise and all the glory. And everyone said, amen.
Amen.
And amen. Amen. You know, this passage that we have read tonight in Exodus chapter 33, it could be viewed as the Philippians 3:10 passage of Moses' life. If you know what Philippians 3:10 says, it's where Paul said about himself, where he shared the thing that he desired in life the most. And Paul said that I might know him.
Yes, yes.
That's what Paul's desire was. Everything else is dung. It's garbage compared to me knowing Jesus. And again, he said in Philippians 3:10, Paul said, that I might know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. Paul's desire more than anything else was he wanted to know Jesus. He didn't want to just know what Jesus did. He wanted to know him. He wanted to know him. I tell you, I'm sick and tired of religion. I'm sick and tired of just going through the motions. I tell you, I've learned this in life. I need to know Jesus. Hallelujah. I can't just know about him. I need to know him. Not just me as a preacher, but you as a layperson or a preacher. You need to know him tonight. And God's heart towards us is he wants us to get to know him. He wants us to get to know him. And this was in Moses, the passage that we've read. This was the Philippians 3:10 passage of Moses' life. Because in this passage, Moses said, Lord, I need to know your way. I need to know your way. I want to know your way. If I have found grace in your sight, then Lord, I need to know you. And I need to know your way. You know, in our own life, in our own Christian life, we can go from being dissatisfied. I'm just not satisfied with where I am. I'm not satisfied with my own walk with the Lord. I know there's more, and I'm just not satisfied. You know what I'm talking about?
Right.
I'm just not satisfied. But you can be in that place of not being satisfied, but eventually you'll get to a place where you can't even stand.
All right.
Come on.
Unless you know him.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes.
Go from a place of I'm not satisfied to a place where I can't even stand unless I know you, Jesus. Unless I know what you did for me in Calvary. Unless I experience that victory that you purchased for me. I can't even make it.
Yes.
And this was in the heart of Moses when he cried out to the Lord. And I encourage you tonight, the most important thing in this life is just knowing Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I said the most important thing is knowing Jesus. And knowing what he did for us at Calvary, all the benefits of what he did for us at Calvary. And not just the head knowledge, but deep on the inside, you know it like you know your name. Hallelujah. So when the devil comes knocking on your door, you're not parroting just some words from somebody else, but you've got something on the inside. Hallelujah. Because you know somebody. I said, you know somebody and you know Jesus. I said, you know him for yourself. There's nothing like knowing Jesus. I said, there's nothing like knowing Jesus. My Lord, there's nothing like knowing Jesus, because the devil will come knocking on your door. God will allow you to eat the bread of affliction at times. You will go through the valley of the shadow of death. But when you go through that valley of the shadow of death, you can be like David. You can say, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Hallelujah. You can say, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not lack anything.
Yes, yes.
Know him. Get to know him. The most important thing in life is just knowing Jesus. Oh, I know I'm repeating myself. I'll say it again. The most important thing in life is just knowing Jesus. Take some time and get to know Jesus. Get to know his word. Get to know what he did for you, Calvary. Just get to know him.
Hallelujah. Yes.
Nothing like knowing Jesus. And the Bible tells us in Psalm 103, verse 7, as it concerns Moses and Israel, The Bible says that he made known his ways to Moses and his acts to the children of Israel. Moses had a close, intimate relationship with God, but Israel from afar only saw what God did. I tell you, I don't want to just look from afar and see what God does.
Right.
Hello, somebody. I don't want to just hear about a revival somewhere else happening in some other city. No, I want him to move in me. I don't want to hear about it just somewhere else. No, I want to know him for myself. I want to know him for myself. You know, I love sports, and I remember when I'm not a Red Sox fan, not at all. I'm a Yankees fan. I'm from New York, so I'm a Yankees fan. But when the Red Sox won the World Series, I forget which year it was, in 2008, maybe something like that. They hadn't won a World Series in, I think, over 100 years or something like that. It was like a long, long time. And then gotten right up to the point where they had gotten into the World Series. And they made t-shirts, and I'll never forget it because it had an effect on me even spiritually. They made t-shirts, and it said, "Why not us?"
Yes.
Why not us?
Come on with that.
Why not us? Why can't we win the World Series? Everybody else seems like they've won the World Series, but why not us? And you know what? They won the World Series that year. They won that year. I tell you, sometimes there needs to be a desperate cry in our own heart that we say, "Why not me, Lord?" You moved back in Azusa Street. You moved in the 50s. You moved in the book of Acts. You moved in many other areas. Why not me, Lord? I need you to move, Lord. I need you to move. Lord, I need you to move. Lord, I need you to pour out your Holy Spirit. You got to be like that lady with an issue of blood. She had to press through the crowd. Sometimes you just got to press in. Forget about everything else. Turn off the radio. Turn off the iPhone. Turn off the computer and just press in and get to know Jesus. And that's what Moses' heart was. And God's response to Moses' heart was these words: "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." God's response to a desperate heart is, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And when God said, "My presence will go with you," he was not talking about his omnipresence. His omnipresence means that he's everywhere all at the same time. He wasn't talking about his omnipresence. He was talking about his manifest presence. The presence of God that you can feel. The presence of God that you know that God is with me. That God is here. Everything around me, it doesn't look like it, but I know that God is with me. I tell you, the presence of God makes all the difference in the world. Hallelujah. One of the things that I'm so thankful about being Pentecostal, that as Pentecostals, we believe in the manifest presence of God.
Yes.
I've been Baptist, and I thank the Lord for that heritage. But I've been Pentecostal. It's much better being Pentecostal.
Amen.
Because we believe in the manifest operation of the Holy Spirit. We believe in the manifest presence of God. And God's response to Moses was, "My presence, my manifest presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." And you have to understand the context in which this was said, because this is in chapter 33. But in chapter 32 is when the golden calf experience took place. You've read about that, I'm sure, before. Earlier, Moses was on the Mount Sinai for 40 days receiving the revelation of the Ten Commandments and receiving the revelation of the tabernacle, his house, that God would personally dwell in. And when he came down, he saw the people dancing. But they weren't dancing before the Lord. They were dancing before a golden calf, a golden idol, a foreign god. And Moses said, "What is this? What is going on?" And he asked his older brother, Aaron, "What's going on, Aaron? What happened?" And Aaron made up the lame excuse that, well, it was the people. They wanted to see something. They were getting impatient, and they wanted to see something. Uh-huh. We live by faith and not by sight. Yeah. But they wanted to see something, Brother Moses. And so I got all their earrings, and we put it in the fire, and all of a sudden, poof! That's the first time I've ever done that. That's the first time that's ever. I'm laughing now.
Hey, we can cut it out.
Never mind. Might as well just keep it in. Well, that's what happened. Just poop. There it was. The golden calf came up. That's what Aaron said. All of a sudden, the golden calf appeared, and the people started worshiping it. And Moses said, and I'm making this short, those who are on the Lord's side, just come over here. And all the Levites came over, and they said, "Okay, take your sword and slay all those who are worshiping the golden calf." And 3,000 people died.
All right.
And the people were stiff-necked people. They were a rebellious people. They needed to see something, and they were wondering, how come this Moses is taking so long on the mountain? How come? And ultimately, their anger was against God. How come God's taking so long? Hello? Sometimes we can do that.
Yes.
Lord, how come you're taking so long? I need to see something. And sometimes we can even build golden calves. Hello? Because we want to see something. Sometimes we'll even make something up out of our own flesh, out of our own imagination, just so we can see something. I encourage you, brother and sister, tonight, don't make something up.
Amen.
Wait upon the Lord. I said, wait upon the Lord. Be of good courage, and He shall strengthen your heart. When that time comes, you're going to see something. Hallelujah. I said, when it's God's timing, you will see something. You will see the blessing of the Lord. I said, you will see it with your own eyes. His word will not return void. It shall accomplish what He set it out to do. You'll see the blessing of God. You'll see it with your own eyes. Don't make something up. Don't be discouraged, but keep living by faith. Keep looking to the one that you can't see in the natural, but keep looking to Him. Keep looking to the one who shed His blood for you. And God said, "My presence will go with you." And Moses, "I'm going to give you rest. I'll take care." What that means is, I'm going to give you rest from all of your enemies. I'm just going to take care of everything. That's ultimately what that means. I'll give you rest. I'll take care of everything. You won't have to stress, because I'll give you rest. Does that mean that when He said that I'll give you rest, did it mean that God was telling Moses and even us that we won't have any enemies? No, we will. Especially if your eyes are upon Jesus and your eyes are upon the cross, you just put a big bullseye on you, because you're a threat to the devil's kingdom. So you're going to have some enemies, but what the Lord will do is He will set a table before you full of His goodness, right in the presence of your enemies. Oh, I love when David said that in Psalm 23. It's like God was telling David, "I'll set a table," but when He said that, "I'll set a table before you, right before you in the presence of your enemies, so your enemies can see my goodness that I'm giving to you, and they can't do anything about it." The devil can't steal from that table, because it's my table. It's God's table. And the devil can't steal from God's table. I said, you can't steal from God's table. Does that mean you won't have enemies? Oh, you will have enemies, but He'll give you rest from fighting those enemies in your own strength.
Amen.
When you trust Him. Because the battle's not ours, the battle is the Lord's.
That's right.
Does that mean that we won't walk through the valley of the shadow of death at times? When God said, I'll give you rest, does that mean that we won't walk through valleys? Oh, yes, we will. But as David said, when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, Lord, you'll be with me. Lord, he even said in Psalm 139, if I make my bed in hell, even there your right hand shall hold me. So you'll go through some valleys. You'll have some enemies. You'll have some difficult times. But in the midst of it all, God, if you trust Him, if you look to Calvary, if you look to His finished work, what He'll do is He'll give you rest on the inside. Hallelujah. I said there ain't nothing like the rest that God gives us. Nothing like rest. When everything else is saying, be stressed. But the Lord says, I give you rest. There's nothing like just receiving it. I tell you, there's nothing like just receiving it. Oh, I love that. There's nothing like just receiving that rest. Where years ago, if that same thing would have taken place, you would have flipped out. Hello? You would have flipped out. You would have gone crazy. You would have pulled your hair out and their hair out and put your in the and before, when you woke up, you would have had your hands around their neck. But now, because you learned to trust Him. Hello? Because you learned to look to Calvary. What happened is now you're just walking in the rest of the Lord. God said, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. There is nothing like the manifest presence of God. Does that mean when God said my presence will go with you, does that mean and to us tonight? Because I receive it and I believe it tonight that it's a promise to every single one of us tonight. I feel it that strong in my spirit. That God's saying that to us corporately, but He's saying it to you personally.
Amen.
As if you were in a room with God all by yourself and He was looking at you right in the eyes. And God was telling you, my presence will go with you, and I will give you rest.
Hallelujah.
My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest. And again, He was talking about His manifest presence, but does that mean that we're always going to, that life is always going to be an Acts 2? A mighty rushing wind? No. Does that mean that we're always going to feel the presence of God necessarily? No. Because sometimes you'll feel you're sitting like you're living right next to hell itself.
Amen.
You got the devil on one side and the Antichrist on the other. You just feel like you feel that bad. I mean, you feel bad. But His presence is still with you. I said His presence is still with you. And tonight, God just wants you to know, and you know it, and know it, and know it, that His presence will go with you, and His presence is with you, and will go with you.
Hallelujah.
You don't have to worry about anything, because if you have the presence of God, that means God is with you. And He'll take care of everything. But there will be times when you will feel the manifest presence of the Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I tell you, there is nothing like the manifest presence of God. I tell you, that's what we need. In my own life, I'm preaching to myself, I need the manifest presence of God. I need to feel, at times, I need to feel Him.
Amen.
I need to.
Yes.
In our church services, we need to feel the presence of God. We just can't be singing and just go through the motions. Hello?
Amen.
Too many times in too many churches, even Message of the Cross churches, sometimes we can get into a rut. And we just go through the motions and we're speaking truth, but there's no presence of God. Hello? There's no presence of God. We need to hunger and thirst for the presence of God.
Amen.
We can't take it as the one that God's just going to show up. No, He won't. If we take God for granted, if we put our faith in the message rather than the one that the message is about, right. Hello?
Yeah. Amen.
Too many people are putting their faith in the message and they become sectarian about it.
Uh-huh.
And they have a party spirit about it. I tell you, we need to look to the one whom the message is about, the message, and that's Jesus and what he did for us at Calvary. He is the author and finisher of our faith. Jesus. Oh, what a mighty name. The devil hates that name. Jesus. Come on, say that name with me. Jesus. Hallelujah. Nothing like the name of Jesus. Nothing like the name of Jesus. Sometimes it's just good to yell it out. Jesus. Hallelujah. Sometimes when you're in an environment when you can't yell it out, you just say it in your spirit.
Come on.
Jesus. That co-worker is cussing like worse than a sailor. But in your spirit, you're saying, Jesus. 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 I praise you. Jesus. I thank you. Jesus, shut that man up. Jesus. Come on, somebody. We can be real. It's all right to be real. Lord Jesus, shut that woman up, please. Jesus. Jesus. I'll tell you what, Jesus will.
Amen.
The Bible says this also about the presence of God. An awesome verse out of Psalm 97 and verse 5. The psalmist said, the mountains melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. What a statement. The mountains melt like wax at the presence of the Lord. Mountains. Mountains of fear melt like wax at the manifest presence of God.
Yes. All right. Good.
Mountains of doubt and confusion, they melt like wax at the manifest presence of God. Just one moment in the presence of God can take care of it all. You've been stressing out for a month, but just one moment in the manifest presence of God. This is how important this is, folks.
Yes.
This is how important it is. Just one moment in the manifest presence of God, and that mountain will just melt like wax. That mountain may be cancer, but it melts like wax. That mountain can be a financial mountain, but it will melt like wax. God will give you wisdom. He'll give you a gift even when you don't expect it. God will give you wisdom on how to deal with it. He's a mountain-moving God. I said he's a mountain-moving God. What mountain do you need him to move tonight? He specializes in moving mountains. Not just moving them, but melting them. So that you can't even tell a mountain was there to begin with. I love what he told Zechariah. He said unto Zerubbabel, he said, who are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you shall become a plain. I'll make that great mountain your enemy. I'll make him a plain. As if he didn't even exist. If you look back in your own life, you used to have some mountains, but when you look back, come on, somebody. Here, when you went over here years ago, and you had some mountains in your way, but the Lord took care of those mountains by the grace of God. Hallelujah. I said by the grace of God, not by your works, but by the grace of God. He melted that mountain. You just kept on going forward. And there was another mountain. It might have been an addiction. It might have been a bondage. Something that nobody else knew about. But he melted that mountain. Through Calvary, he took care of that mountain. And you went forward. And when you look back in your life, you don't see mountains. You see just a smooth, level plain.
Lord,
you know what that is? You know what that smooth, level plain is? That's your testimony. I said that's your testimony. So you can tell people and you can tell the Lord too. And you can just remind yourself, there used to be a mountain right there. I know you can't tell it, but there used to be a mountain right there.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's why sometimes you can tell people, I used to be a drug addict. What? You? I used to be this and I used to be that. No, there's no way. Hello, we don't do that anymore. I've had people, I got saved when I was a young age. So I can't tell you a testimony of before I got saved, I was a drug addict or an alcoholic or anything. I can't tell you that as a part of my testimony.
Praise God, that's all right.
But I will tell you this. I still have a testimony.
Yes.
And my testimony is that he kept me from all
Amen.
Those things.
All right. Hallelujah.
Because if it wasn't for the Lord, if I look in my family history, all I got to do is just look real close in my family.
All right.
If I look in my family history, that's exactly where I would have been going.
Amen.
If not for the keeping power of God.
Amen.
So he kept me from those things. Some of you got into those things and you got what the Lord delivered you out of it.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Unto God. But he's a mountain moving God. And the Lord said to Moses, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. But then, you know, I want to go back to verse 12 for a moment, just for a moment, because I want to bring something up there. And we're coming to an end. It says, then Moses, in verse 12, then Moses said to the Lord, see, you have said to me, bring up this people, or bring this people up. But you have not let me know whom you will send with me. And Moses made that statement to the Lord. Lord, you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You've not told me. Lord, I need somebody to go with me.
All right.
I need an associate.
All right.
Come on.
I need somebody with me, and you, Lord, you have not told me who will go with me. And I want to bring some out because right there, that was actually as great of a man of God as Moses was. That was doubt and frustration in the heart of Moses. Because in this passage earlier in chapter 33 and also in chapter 32, the Lord told Moses that I will send my angel before you. This is what I'm going to do for you, Moses. I'm going to give you my angel. And my angel was the pre-incarnate Christ. You can't get any better than that. Will go with you and he'll go before you and he'll take care of all the ites.
All right. Yeah.
The Jebusites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Termites, all the fleshites, all the ites. He'll take care of all of them. My angel will go with you. And not only did God say my angel will go with you, but also God gave to Moses the man named Joshua. We read in Joshua chapter 33 earlier on this passage that at times Moses would go into his own tent. This is before the tabernacle was built. And he had his own tent. It was called the Tabernacle of Meeting. This is even before the tabernacle actually was built. But Moses would go in and just spend time with the Lord. And Joshua would go in with him. And the Bible says that Moses would come out, but Joshua would tarry. Would tarry. He would tarry in the tabernacle of meeting. He would talk to the Lord some more. And God gave Moses Joshua. And eventually that same Joshua would lead God's people across the Jordan River into the promised land. And God gave Moses Joshua. But Moses said, Lord, you haven't told me. When in reality, God did.
Yeah.
I just want to make this quick point real quickly. Because it concerns what God speaks to us sometimes. I tell you, God sometimes, even like tonight, like God is telling us tonight, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. You don't have to worry about anything. Just trust me. I'm going to be with you. God can give us a word like that. And we can walk out of here in 5 minutes, something, we can get a phone call or a text. And our response is, God, where are you?
Amen.
Hello? God, where are you? God, where are you? And God just said, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest.
All right.
You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
God can speak to us a clear word, can speak to us, and then something in the natural can happen, and our response is, Lord.
Come on. Yes. That's right.
Lord, where's your word? What, Lord, you haven't told me who you're going to send with me, when in reality, God did. I encourage you tonight, stop listening to yourself.
Yes. Amen. That's right. Absolutely.
Because our own rotten, stinking thinking, our own flesh, we don't even need the devil's help. So the devil, he just said, hey, he's got enough flesh. Go ahead and let the flesh take care of him. But our own flesh, when the Lord has given us a promise in his word, or God's given you something special in your heart and he's given it to you in prayer, and God says something to you, I tell you, sometimes it's just good to, and my wife is, she's challenged me and she's taught me this. When God speaks to you and you really know it's the Lord, write it down. See, go back and remember it. And I do it on my iPad now. I write it down. But sometimes God can tell us things and we forget so easily. And we start, instead of listening to when we're challenged, because every word is going to be challenged. Every promise is going to be challenged. Challenged by life, challenged by the devil, challenged by people, challenged by our own flesh. And when it's challenged, don't listen to your flesh. Don't listen to people. Listen to God. Listen to God. What did God say? Hello? I said, what did God say about my problem? Oh, Brother Bob, I've got a sin issue in my life. I've got a sin problem in my life. And I don't know what to do. Well, you've been hearing the message of the cross. You've been hearing that your deliverance is in what Jesus did for you at Calvary.
Yes.
You've been hearing it. You know it. You've been hearing it. You've been hearing it. You've been receiving it. And you've been believing it.
Yes.
But I don't know what to do. Wait. Listen to yourself.
Right.
Hello? I don't know what to do. Listen to you. You've been hearing the message. You've been hearing your way of victory.
Yes.
Listen to what God has said.
Yes.
Your way of victory is through the blood of Jesus.
Yes.
The same way you got in is the same way you stay in.
Yes.
As you have received Christ Jesus, so walk ye in him. The way he gave you victory at the beginning is the way he'll give you victory now.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's not by all of your striving. It's not by all of your worrying. It's not by all of your working. It's by your simply believing and trusting in him.
Amen.
So do I encourage you tonight, don't listen to yourself.
Yes.
When there's other voices that are saying contrary to what God has said, don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. Tune them out. And turn your frequency only to God's channel. I said turn your frequency only to God's channel. And his channel is this right here. And there's an iPad, but it's got the word on it. That's God's frequency. His word is his frequency. Just turn it to God's frequency. Just his, I'm just going to listen to God's word.
That's right.
I want to hear the truth.
Yes.
And nothing but the truth.
Yes.
And Moses' response was this, and the team can come back. Moses' response to that promise that God gave to him in verse 14 was this. He said, Lord, if your presence does not go with us, then do not bring us up from here. Lord, if your presence does not go with us, the Lord bring us not. Don't take. Lord, I know what you just said. Lord, if your presence doesn't go with us, don't take us up from here. Again, I said at times in our life we go from, I'm just not satisfied. But I tell you what God will do. He'll bring us to a point where we can say we're truly in our spirit. We become so desperate that we say, Lord, I can't even stand without you. I can't stand without you. I'm not just not satisfied anymore, but Lord, I can't even stand. That's in essence what Moses was saying. God, I thank you. And you know what that statement there in verse 15? It wasn't Moses doubting God. It was Moses desperate for God. Because Moses had already been, he had already been through enough. My God.
Praise the Lord.
He had already been through enough to realize this. Lord, if your presence doesn't go with me, we can't make it. Because these people are a stiff-necked people, and I can't do it on my own.
Yes.
I can't do it on my own. I ask you tonight, is that your heart? I can't do it on my own. I can't make it on my own. I can't make it in ministry on my own. I can't be the mother that I need to be on my own. I can't be the wife. I can't be the husband or the father that I need to be on my own. I can't be the pastor. I need to be on my own. I need your presence. I need your presence more than just on Sunday morning during praise and worship. Lord, I need your presence at home. I need your presence in the car. I need your presence when I'm at work. I need your presence, Lord, when I'm in that place of prayer. Lord, I need your presence. Lord, if your presence doesn't go with me, Lord, don't take me up from here. That wasn't doubt. It was desperation. And God honored his desperation. And God renewed that word and said, Moses, I'm going to do what you've asked of me. Because, and I'll paraphrase now, I'm going to do what you asked me because you believed me and you asked in faith. And I know you by name. And you found grace in my sight. So Moses, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to do what you asked me. My presence is real with you. And I'll give you rest. Would you stand to your feet tonight?